Focus, regardless of all anything that's happening around you or what's going on in your life, when you put your focus on Him, He already knows what we need before we ask. But when we ask, He is there. He's a friend of God. We're a friend of His. He's there. He's right there to give us exactly what we need. He knows in advance already what we need. Hallelujah. Come on, friend of God. Come on, hallelujah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Sometimes and you think you're not worth what God has already said that you are. And I don't know why I'm saying that this morning. I'm saying it to somebody. But God made you and He has labeled you. And there's no label whatsoever that man can put on you that will override what God has put on you. There is no label. So what we do sometimes is that we step outside of the call that God has placed on us. God has called each one of us. We all, and I've said this before, we all have a mission. God has given all of us a purpose. And when we sometimes feel the burdens and the weight of the world falling down on us, then we say, well, I'm not worthy of what God has called me to do. Not so. Not so. God has called you and placed you and put you where He wants you to be. And now there may be times that, you know, I mean, I know I'm speaking for myself. that God had to take me, and I've said this before, he took me down to a place where Steve used to think he was above everything. There was nothing and no one better than me. That was just the mentality that I had, not because I was arrogant, but because of background and military background and different things that we've done. We just put yourself that there is nothing else in the world bigger or better than I am. And God brought me to a point and he said, yes, I am. I am bigger. I am the Alpha. I am the Omega. I am everything. And he took me through his basic training. And he raised me up now to be who I am today. But always remember, he loves you. He loves you. He's called you and he has placed you. Hallelujah. Give a hand graciously. Come on, lift your hands and just worship. Hallelujah. He is jealous for me. Love like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipse my glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affection upon me. Come on, let's sing.
Thank you.
loves us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How many here know that he has won the victory for you? Come on, hallelujah. Come on, if you know that he's won the victory, I shouldn't have to boost you to say that. You should be given the glory.
Hallelujah.
He's won the victory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You have won it all.
Jesus' name. God, you are our champion, God. You've won the victory, Lord. You're standing on the podium of life, God, with the gold medal, God. And today, because we place our hope and our lives in your hands, we too got victory, God. Oh, if you have victory in the house of God, give him a shout today. You got victory today.
We welcome you here today. We thank you for being here and being a part of this worship time together unto the Lord. Before we get into our offering and our new visitor, I want to offer up a prayer. Trudy, raise your hand, Trudy. She's in the back. See her back there. You know Trudy, the guys. Been with us now about what, almost 6 months now?
Got a big hug for my girl.
My wife and I have known Trudy for a long time from a former church, and she knows Scott Rosenberger very well. She's been worshiping up with us. Now she's become good friends with Carmen and Pop and a few others. But we've prayed before for her nephew. Nephew's been going through a real tough time in his body. He's going to have surgery in Orlando. The doctor's already going into the surgery saying, we don't really see a very good positive thing coming from this. When you go talk to a doctor, you ask the doctor, what's my chances? You'd like to at least be able to have a fighting chance, you know, and doctor's not giving him a good chance. But I was telling her that perhaps he's talking to the wrong doctor. So we have a doctor, he's a great physician that always has a better report than that, you know. So she asked for prayer. So I just thought before we did the offering, before we acknowledge our new guest, that we would go ahead and just say a prayer right now for a successful surgery. Father God, in Jesus' name, it isn't important, God, that we don't know this individual personally. It really even isn't important that Trudy knows this individual personally as a family member. What's important that you know this person personally. And because you give great stock in those that you know personally, because you gave your life on the cross for him, we believe right now that his healing has already been paid at Calvary. The stripes on your back already bore his healing right now. And we believe that the report of the devil is null and void, and the report of the Lord is that he is healed, he is set free, and he is delivered. Today we pray that you would guide the surgeon's hand. Give them supernatural wisdom, knowledge, and discernment. And oh God, what the devil meant for harm, God, may you mean for good. Turn this thing around to the glory of God and bring healing to his body. For this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Today, before we take up the offering, we want to acknowledge our new visitors. If you're a new visitor today, I'm looking around, my eyes may be failing me a little bit. Do we have any new visitors? Right over here. Give this young lady a hand clap over here. Part of Mr. Green's family here. She's here today with us. Thank you for being here, sweetheart. Throw out that card. We have a free gift for you before you leave, okay? When you leave, the front foyer, get yourself a free gift. I don't think it'll be an iPod. I think it might be something some folks like. But anyway, thank you for being here today. Today, if you are here to worship the Lord, how many are here to worship the Lord? Another way we worship him is by giving. It's by giving. You know, when I first got saved, I was told something a long time ago. And I was told that the money that I made wasn't mine, it belonged to him. Now that was an eye-opener for me, because I always thought it was mine. You know, I saw my name on the paycheck, and when I went to the bank, my name was on the bank account that I signed in the back of my check, so I thought it had to be mine, but I found out through God's word that it really belongs to him. I say that because when you give, and you know it belongs to him, you're giving not only because you trust him and you love him, and you're being obedient to him, but you're giving as an act of worship. You're saying, God, I'm going to worship you in my giving. Now, I realize that some of us can't give. We're not in a position this day financially to give. But if you give from your heart, even if you give him an IOU, you know what God will do? He'll make it possible in the days to come for you to give financially. So right now, Father, in the name of Jesus, we're going to give you these tithes, these offerings above them. And we're going to give it as a heart of worship this morning, knowing that it belongs to you, God. Anything we have, it's been given to us on lease. So God, take this offering this morning. May it further your kingdom. May it give you glory and praise. And in turn, may you bless us and keep us going in the right direction financially. For God, we pray this to you, glory and honor, in Jesus' name. Amen. Give as you can here this morning. I'm going to have her in just a minute. Just a minute, she's going to lead a prayer for us. For a special person, a special family. Today, Joey Cruz will be here with us for the last Sunday. He'll come back and visit from time to time, sure. He has no choice. His family lives here. He has to come back and visit. But he's going away to college. Isn't that a good thing?
Yeah.
And the best thing is he's not going to Chicago, Mom. He's not going to California. He's going to Tampa, about an hour and 15 minutes away. You know, I can show you how to get there. I lived there all my whole life before I moved to it. I'm sure you'll see him a lot. But today, he'll be his last official service with us, and I think Mom's taking it worse than he is. I'm looking at her back there. But I like Joey to come up here. I like the family to come up here. I like Mary and Carmen and Pop and Mark and the kids. I'm Aris to come up here. And I like some of the leadership that's around them up here. And I like my wife to lead a prayer over Joey and for blessings over there at school and safety and provision. But also comfort to be upon Mary and the family because she's already missing him and he hasn't even left yet. That's a mother's heart, right? And Pop's missing, that's a grandfather. Joey, we love you, we're proud of you. My son will be leaving one day, my daughter will be leaving, we'll have the same emotions. Can you stand with us and stretch your hands forward? Come on, let's be a body of family of God here that loves his family. I'd like my wife to lead this prayer of blessings over Joey and comfort over the family. Go ahead,
Father. Father God, we come to you, Lord Jesus, for your precious son, Joey. Lord, we thank you that you have blessed them so much to be able to go to college, oh God. That you provided a way, Father God, to make this young gentleman to go over to college and make a life of himself, Lord God. Make a living, Father God, as long as he is still breathing, Father God, that he can move forward, oh God. Lord, I don't doubt his abilities, oh God. I don't doubt that he can do it, Father God. Lord, I don't doubt anything about him. All I'm asking you, Lord God, is that if he is away from his family, that you would put a hedge of protection over him,
yes,
Father
Lord,
God. That no weapon that is formed against him will prosper, Father God. That no peer pressure, Father God, against the wiles of the enemy out there will overcome him, but he will be able to say no and focus on his studies, oh God. And above all, Lord Jesus, focus on you, for it is where you have put him, God. It is where you have placed him, where you have allowed him to go, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray that nothing, Lord God, will deter him from his goal, oh God. And Lord, I pray an amount of peace upon his mother and father, Lord Jesus. Lord, I know it's only an hour away, but as a mother and father, God, we are just, Lord Jesus, just like you. Lord, we love our children. We love them close to us. We want them close to us, Lord God. And I pray a peace measure over them right now, Lord.
Yes, God.
I pray, Father God, that they would know without a shadow of a doubt that you have Joey in the palm of your hands and you are walking with him side by side. And in those moments when he doesn't have mom and dad or pop or mom around him, he has you to turn to, Lord God, and he can turn to you and you will answer, Lord God. And Lord, I pray, Lord Jesus, a hedge of protection over all this family, Lord God. This is a precious family, Father God, that is a good example, Lord Jesus, for our church, oh God, of what an example of what a family should be, Lord God. Togetherness, love, Father God. And Lord, above all, Father God, peace. Peace in the midst of the storm.
Yes.
Peace in the midst, Father God, of despair. And Lord, when those moments that the mother or father are missing their son, Lord God, that peace will enter, Father God.
Yes.
And Lord, above all, I pray for Pop, oh Lord. Lord Jesus, it's not that he's special. He is special for his grandson. Yes. He is special, Lord God. I pray a measure of peace above Pop and Mom. Lord Jesus, just bless them, Lord God, and help them, Father God. Give them, Father God, a measure. measure of peace, Lord, that in any circumstance, Lord God, they will be there also for their grandson, Lord Jesus. Lord, I give you all the glory and all the praise for what you're doing in Joey's life and what you will continue to do, Father God, and the rest of the children of this family. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
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 Hallelujah. That kind of prayer makes all of them want to go to college. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. By way of a few announcements, we have today the last day for life group signups out there in the foyer. Last Sunday for this semester, we have three groups, but you've heard from Tom and Marsha about therapy. We'd like to give a small spotlight to the other two, real small. So I'd like Alan Thatcher and Jimmy Barter to come up here and join us on the platform. They're going to give both a quick little sign-up to know you're going to miss a blessing in your life. So why don't you give these two guys a nice hand clap here today.
The Truth Project. We're going to be doing that on Tuesday nights, 7 o'clock right here in the church. We're going to set up tables to be able to sit down, have your books. We'd like at least every couple to have one book. If you're single, please get a book. It's very important, okay? We're going to have fun. You're going to meet people you never knew before and what you're going to learn. Like Joey, you're going off to college. You're going to, the professors are going to twist you.
Yes.
You have to be strong in the Word. And this project helps you to do that. If you're not reading your Word every day, for example, that song Steve sang at the beginning, I've Got a Friend in God. I can't tell you how many times I read that scripture, but I didn't think that song was scripturally, and I prayed about it, and the Lord showed me, John 15:15, you're no longer a servant. Well, that's what this is about. You're going to meet people you never knew before. You're going to learn to like them. It's going to be a great class. Thank you.
Hey, how y'all doing? I wrote down what I need to say so I don't get it wrong, because this print is so small. It's really kind of, it's this little space right here on the back of the thing. I was with a magnifying glass and everything else trying to read this last night, so I had to write it down. But what I'm doing is, this is Bike Together, Growing to Be Like Christ. It's a continuation of the purpose-driven life. It takes you to the next step. It teaches you how to walk in Christ and to be still in God. And this is what I wrote. Being saved and making it into heaven is only the beginning. We are called to be like Christ in our actions. 1 Peter 1:14-16 says, as obedient children, do not be conformed to the former lust which were yours in your ignorance, but like the Holy One who called you, be holy yourself, also in your behavior. Because it's written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. Now that little blue part I showed you on the back says this. Spiritual maturity does not happen by accident. The 6 sessions in this study equip you for the basic habits of spiritual growth. Relying on the Holy Spirit, cultivating time in the Bible and prayer, seeing life's obstacles as opportunities for growth, and partnering with Christians who are committed to support your growth. Here is a realistic and practical path to growing strong in faith and in Christian character. Come, join us on our journey into discipleship that I am sure will change life as you now see it. Thank you.
I have the final group of this semester, and I asked him also, even though his group's almost full, not full quite yet, couple more, so go ahead and give a pitch.
We could still have more. It's transforming the inner man. And I was talking earlier about how God took me back through basic training and built me. And then I thought I was okay. But then there was even still more. There are some deep, deep issues that we have that we haven't let go, or that we haven't forgiven someone else or even forgiven ourselves. And that's what this corner is about, transforming the inner man. When I was going through my after my surgery, and I had a lot of anger built up in me, and didn't, and I thought that I had forgiven, kind of sort of forgiven the doctor that had caused this to me, and thanks for to Marsha and Tom, who went over to their house and sat with them and went through a bit of this, and I'm telling you what, this stuff gets deep. I mean, it really, really gets deep. So this is what God wants to help us to do also, because when we get rid of those deep things, then we can really focus on Him. Sometimes it's stuff that's so deep that we think it's all done. It's over with. But that's what this one is about. Transforming the inner man gets really deep, and you'll love it. So again, sign up for it.
Thank you, Steve. The new people having their lock-in here at the church. A lock-in means they, once they get in, they don't leave. We lock the church down. They're locked in until the next morning, okay? It's on Friday night, the 21st of August, 7 p.m. till like, what, 8 o'clock next morning, something like that?
Between 8 and 9, yeah.
Between 8 and 9. And it was always a great time. The last lock-in they had, when we came here the next morning, the men were coming here for the meet for something, we couldn't believe how many teams they had. I said, where's all these teams on the regular Sunday, on Sunday service? But they were here, they had a great time, they're going to have another great time. So the sign-up sheet's in the back for the lock-in. Also, on September the 4th, Friday night, September the 4th, the men and women are going bowling together, Manatee Lanes. It's a joint bowling time. That's a fun time. There's no Bible study there, folks. We just come there and we bowl together. I never forget, I saw, how many of you know that the supernatural work of God can show up in a bowling alley? We went bowling with the men a while back down here at the Beverly Hills Bowl, and some of these guys can bowl pretty good. Some of these guys, they need to try something different. But anyway, Mr. Norman back there, he threw a gutter ball. And he said, in the name of Jesus, he spoke to that ball, and it popped out of the gutter and hit a strike. Remember, guys, we were there, we saw it. I said, there is a God in Israel, look at that. And he bows. But come out, there's a sign-up sheet in the back, September the 4th, men's and women bowling, it'll be a fun time. You won't regret it. Do we have a Sam Bachman? Where's Sam Bachman? Come here, Sam, she has a quick announcement. Make her feel welcome. Come on, Sam.
Amen.
Oh, it's just so wonderful. So, there are some new people in church who probably may not know. I'm involved in a sign ministry. On Wednesday, from 9 till noon, this Wednesday, we'll be at the corner of 19 and 44. We hold signs saying, honk for Jesus, honk if you love Jesus, coming soon, Jesus, and one nation under God, under Jesus, we say to him, right, sorry. And we just have fun. We praise and we get the public to get to be reminded and to fill their hearts with our Lord. And I'd love to have some of you come out if you would. So it's Wednesday, 9 to 12. You can come anytime you want. And a group from Spring Hill will be coming up, so there will be a nice bunch of us. So hope to see you. Thank you.
Sunday. Yeah, there's a typo in the bulletin. It's not the third Sunday for the nursing home ministry. It's always on the fourth Sunday. The fourth Sunday of every month after service, they go to the nursing home ministry. So make that the fourth Sunday. Also, two more quick ones. We have no board meeting this coming Thursday. For those of you that are on our board, no board meeting this Thursday. Somebody in the church is turning 50 years of age. I won't tell you who it is. So he's canceled the board meeting. But it'll be this Thursday night. But those of you that are on the board, we will be reconvening the first Thursday of September to try to get both September and August in. It's good to have Sunette back. She went to France to see some missionaries of ours that she's real dear to, her daughter and son-in-law. And how are they doing over there? They're doing marvelous. Also in her hand, she's got the fishing trip tickets. For those of you that want to go on the deep sea fishing trip, that is for both men and women, is $55 a ticket. So please, let's not wait till the last minute. We have to make sure we have reservations for this boat. So if you want to buy your ticket, get with Sunette after service and she'll make sure that you get one. And one more thing, every time we have a five Sunday month, this is a fifth Sunday month, where a month has five Sundays in it. Every time we have that, on that fifth and final Sunday, we take up an extra seat offering for our new building. That's this month. We want you to begin to pray and ask the Lord what He would have you to give. You know, we told you about 3 or 4 months ago that we were running a little short. We were like 31,000 short. When I say short, I don't mean short as far as the project's not going to go through. The project is going to go through by the grace of God. But there are things that are coming up that we have to pay for out of pocket before the banks give us money. See, when the banks give you money, the banks are paying the contractor, and they start doing the project, and we pay the bank back later. But there's things we have to do right now, like permitting and hiring a contractor and different things that come from us. How many of you would like to be sitting in even better chairs at the new church?
Yeah.
I know I would like to sit in some better chairs. You know, if we're gonna have, you know, let's say even 200, 220 chairs in the sanctuary, chairs are about $40 a piece. Okay, do the math. That's like $8,000, okay, to have chairs. We will have future chair campaigns. We will do certain things that everybody can, you know, can purchase a chair. Now, if you buy a chair, if you leave the church, you can't take the chair with you. Okay? You know, can't do that now. But you know what I'm talking about. But the point of the matter is, though, we need your giving. You know, we all committed, a lot of us, about a year or two ago, we committed to give monthly to the new building, and we also committed to sow a fifth Sunday seed. So please, pray and trust God and ask God what you would give this fifth Sunday in 2 weeks toward the new building. Because, folks, it's just around the corner. Matter of fact, on that Sunday, I'm going to give the pitch, the big pitch, and show you where we're at in the new building and how much God would ask of you and how much you could expect from Him. So you should be excited. It's going to be a good Sunday. Amen? I don't believe I have any more announcements. That being said, why don't we bow our heads? Father God, we give you praise here today. God, we give it to you as people now submitting to you. See, the praise and the worship already belongs to you. We don't have to give it to you. You already have it. But we want to give it to you, God, because that's our way of saying we're with you. We adore you. We love you. We honor you. God, bless this message. Open up the ears of your people, God. Help them to hear what they've never heard before. Hide me. Don't let them hear me. Help them to hear you today, and may this place be impacted by it for the good. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. You ever heard of the old movie, the old saying that says, if you build it, they will come? My uncle in Tampa has had 3 restaurants. He built each restaurant with the intention that if I build it, they'll come. And they came for a season, and the season was over with, and the restaurant went into bankruptcy 3 different times. They say it's hard to have a successful restaurant. The competition out there is very fierce. What I'm saying here is I think you just can't build something without having plans and a foundation to make it be everything it is when people come to it. You know, I've been to ball games, I've been to parties, I've been to things that never lived up to the billing. I remember not long ago we went to Steve Parrish's house, all of us guys went to see the fights. We talked about the fights the whole time, we were looking for the main fight, and the fights on the undercard were better than the main fight. We were all disappointed. It didn't live up to its billing. We're going to be building a new church here real soon. Probably, if the Lord will be with us, probably before the year's end, you'll be able to drive down 491. You'll be able to see bulldozers out there. You'll be able to see the land starting to be cleared and prepped for that new building. And then sometime in the part of spring, you'll hopefully start seeing maybe a foundation already being, a slab being slayed, and you'll start to see the thing come to reality. But just because you have a slab out there and a land being cleared and all the blueprinting and everything going into effect does not make that church good automatically. It just makes a building that we're putting down there. What makes that church good or not is you and I. But God's already good. It just makes you and I. You and I are the difference makers in that church. Today I want to talk to you about cultivating a healthy church. You might say, is there such thing as a sick church? Yeah. Oh, yes, there is. I've been to a few. Is there such thing as a dead church? I've been to a few of them, too. I want to begin by asking you a couple of questions that I heard posed to us at the district council. I want to ask you, and by a show of hands, I want you to play along with me. How many of you, by a show of hands, got saved in the church? Okay? Look around, guys. Can you keep the hands up?
By a show of hands, how many of you have overcome a stronghold in a church? It's a tough situation. How many of you have gotten married in a church? Okay. How many of you met friends that you even still have today in a church? See? And again, how many of you have been inspired to serve God in ministry in a church? You see, I start this message off by asking these questions because God wants us to know that the church is very, very important to the success of a life that you and I are supposed to live. And it's very successful in the community that we're trying to reach, the church. You see, if a church is healthy, those that from the community that embrace the church's doors, they too will become healthy. But if a church is not healthy, when people embrace our doors, those that come in will catch the virus that we have. And they will become sick, and they will become more damaged than they were before they even came in. You see, today as your pastor, I want to know, where are we as a church today? Before we go over to the new building, when the air conditioning works all the time, when we go to the new building where nothing is leaking from the ceiling, hopefully, and where if it's raining, you can drive underneath underneath the garage and get dropped off and not have to come in soaking wet. When we come to the new church with all of its wonders and everything it has to offer, what kind of church are we going to be over there? Because, you know, I'm a firm believer that if you haven't settled that thing, like Steve was saying, that inner thing inside you, if you don't get it settled, you're going to take it wherever you go. Many people have taken problems from other churches and brought it over here and made our church a problem. Yes. You're saying, not me. And some of you, when I said that, just did this, look. Are we as a church on the verge of moving to a new location and where we're going to be a positive influence to that community and bring a healthy bit of God to that community, or are we going to be part of the problem that the unhealthy community already has? You see, are we an unhealthy church that are going to go over there and just add to this poor community's problem they have already, the problem of sin, or are we going to be a healthy church that when people come in, they can have a solution to their lives? Yes. You see, a church is a place where the church, the believers in God, congregate together to worship God, to grow in God, to grow their faith in God. We come together to strengthen and encourage each other in God, and we come together to be equipped in God so that we can do what? Go out and share the good news to those around us. If we are not equipped, if we are not healthy, when we go over there to try to reach that community, we're spreading a virus to a community that already is sick enough and damaged enough. Folks, we have got to be healthy when we go over there. Now, I know that we live in a fallen world. Sin is rampant. Even creation suffers because of sin. But we can still be healthier than we are right now. You know, I believe that some of us have just kind of settled. Settled. Have settled and said, this is the best they're going to get for me. Settled and say, I've already reached a certain age already. I'm not going to change no more. Folks, I'm here to tell you that every day we're supposed to be changing. Every day we're supposed to be getting more and more like the image of Christ. Every day. We can't afford to settle. We can't afford to say, I'm not moving anymore. I'm not changing anymore. I'm going to be this way. You know what? If that is the way we think, then no wonder the world out there thinks the church is insane. Because that is the definition of insanity. Doing the same thing over and over and expecting a different result. That is insanity, folks. We've got to change. We've got to change. Every time somebody talked to me and said, Pastor, you've come such a long way. I said, man, I just touched the surface, man. I haven't even gotten nowhere in God yet. Nowhere in God. So we have to get healthy as a church. You see, God wants us to be a church that's thriving, not just surviving. A church that's flourishing and running past the finish line, not just crawling past the finish line. Wants to be one that is not only growing in our faith, but growing in our love, growing in our tolerance for one another. You know that I heard some of you say, and it's really a sad commentary, that say, you know what, I get more mercy from those that are not of the church than I do of the church. those of the church, those that don't know Jesus Christ, those on your workplaces, those at your schools, give you more love, give you more mercy, give you more forgiveness than those of your own body of Christ. Isn't that a sad commentary? Yeah. Folks, as long as we keep talking about it, but don't change it, we'll never get healthy.
Come on.
Oh, Pastor, you're just being naive. We got some real junkyard dogs here at the church. Well, yeah. Well, let's tame them. Let's turn them into poodles.
Yeah.
Why not? Steve, we got another, whoever served in the military here, put your hands up. See? These people here are willing to die for our country. They were tough dudes. And now they're soft and love Jesus and talking about love and everything from the podium. We can change. Well, call him some Papa Bear. She called him Papa Bear. Bet you his people he served under Steve didn't call him Papa Bear. But I called him Grizzly Bear. You see, folks, I believe we're quickly running out of time. Not only are we running out of time for the new building of beer before we know it, but we're running out of time because Jesus is coming back soon. He's coming back soon, and you say, well, great, come, Lord Jesus. No, because some of us are not ready to stand before him and give him the account that he wants to hear from us. And I'm not saying about salvation. I'm saying about what he's going to say to some of us like this. Man, what were you thinking? My spokesperson, that guy down there that you didn't think much of, was sharing with you for years upon years how to get things better, and you refused to do it because you figured, I'm retired, I'm not moving from my stance. What were you thinking of what God's going to say? And because you thought that way, because of your love for me and the grace and mercy of my son, you get to come to my paradise, sure, but see that place over there? That's not yours. You're in an outhouse over there. That's what you're going to be occupying heaven with. You could have had that, but you wouldn't move from your position. You see, the Bible says that everything may be permissible for us, but not everything is beneficial. You can act any way you want to act, and I can act any way I want to act, but at the end of the day, it's really not a good thing to do if you know as it goes against God's grain. So we're quickly running out of time. Jesus is going to come here pretty soon. I believe he's on the horizon. I believe there are things taking place right now that he's getting ready to come back. I really believe that, folks.
Amen.
It's of the utmost importance that that's the case, that we start getting healthier. Not being complacent, not being saying that we've already arrived, and we're holding on until he comes. We got to get better. Because I'm telling you right now, I believe that at that new church, we're going to enter into a new dynamic over there. We're going to get people there people that have needs, sure, but we also may get people there that know right from wrong, and they can tell the difference. They can tell the difference. You might say, well, we have people here that can't tell the difference? Yeah, I think so sometimes. At one time, I couldn't tell the difference. Folks, a lot of you don't realize this, but I don't know where you came from. I can tell you where I came from. When I used to wake up on Sunday morning, I've said this before and I'll say it again for some of the newer people here that have been coming here. When I used to wake up in the morning, I didn't shake my fist to heaven and boycott church. I didn't shake my fist and say, God, I'm not going to serve you today. I'm going to go to the Buccaneer game. Or I'm going to go fishing. I never even thought of any of it. I was blind and I had scales on my eyes. My heart was hard. I didn't even think any of it. See, we could be in error because of our blindness, not even know the difference. But once we know the difference, the Bible says we are without excuse. And folks, I got to be honest with you. I'm not trying to toot my own horn here, but I've been preaching my heart out for 4 years trying to let us know the difference. And how long are we going to be hearers and not doers of the difference? There comes a time when you got to say, you know what, I'm going to get healthy, and that's just all there is to it. If the person next to me don't want to get healthy, that's their problem. They can answer to God, but by God, I'm going to get healthy. I'm going to get healthy for Jesus. That's where I'm at. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So how do we get healthy? I'm going to start off explaining to you how do we get healthy by giving you a real dirty word. Discipline. We must discipline ourselves in the Word. Nobody wants to be disciplined. Nobody does. Discipline. Listen, if you're on a diet here, you have to discipline yourself. You can't eat that cheesecake at midnight. Am I right or wrong? You can't eat pizza. You can't drink a lot of soda. You know, us guys like me with a six-pack, we don't have that problem. $18. But you, if you want to diet, you have to be disciplined. Same thing, if you have an spending problem, you know, some of you ladies that love to go shopping, you know you have a spending problem? My wife told me this one day, remember this, honey? I said, why don't we go out somewhere, grab something to eat, and then we'll go out window shopping? She goes, no prospective shopper goes window shopping. If I ain't got no money, I'm not going. A lot of you ladies say amen to that. But if you're trying to budget and you're trying to save money for that rainy day and take care of some things in your life, you got to be disciplined. You got to say, you know what? I can't afford that, you know? Got that champagne taste on a Kool-Aid budget. You can't do that. We got to be disciplined. How many of you know that if you want to get better in life for God, you have to be disciplined? And it starts by being disciplined in the Word. A.W. Tozer says it this way. We must allow, he says, the Word of God to confront us, to disturb our security, to undermine our complacency, and to overturn our patterns of thought and behavior, he says, in order to truly live like people who are well and not sick. But look what he says here. Here's the problem in the very first line. We have to allow the Word of God to confront us. A lot of us don't like confrontation. Think about it. The reason why we allow, pardon the expression, I'm just using this expression, crazy to be crazy, it's because we don't want to confront crazy. We don't want to call it what it is. You know what, folks? Like him or don't like him. Whether he wins or don't win is not the point here. The reason why Donald Trump's numbers are going through the roof is because he's not afraid of confrontation. Amen. He's confronting the issues. Amen. Now, granted, he may not be saying things the right way, but he's calling it the way he sees it. Washington is broke. Things are not working right. Let's call it the way it is. Stop being so politically correct. We have to be able to face some confrontation. In love, mind you, but confrontation nonetheless. And that starts, that confrontation starts off with the Word of God. What does the Word of God expect out of me? What does it expect out of you? I said before that Mark Twain, the great writer, said that it wasn't the things in the Bible that he didn't understand, Mark Twain said that he read, that disturbed him. He said what disturbed him was the things in the Bible that he did understand, but he wasn't doing. That disturbed him. You see, we have to understand that the Bible will confront us in who we really are. And it will either make us healthy or it will make us sick. Anyway, we look at it. Let me tell you something. Right now, a lot of us have health issues, including your pastor. But I'm going to tell you right now, and I'm going to confront you as I'm confronting myself with it. Some of our health issues, we can't help. They're just life. Genetics are just health. But some of our health issues are our own fault. Our doctor has given us a regimen to go by, a discipline regimen, and we still don't do it. My doctor told me not to eat pizza and drink soda, and I still do it. And before some of y'all laugh, so do y'all. I've seen y'all. I've been to your house before. It's disciplining. It's saying, doctor, you're right. Well, our great heavenly physician, our doctor Jesus, is saying we have to be disciplined in the Word. Because the Word will help us to be a healthy church. A healthy church. You go over to visit people's houses as a pastor, and you see a Bible on a coffee table. See, you know, people always bring their Bible out when the pastor's coming over. You know that. They take the Sports Illustrated out and put the Bible there. But you know that Bible nothing more than a showpiece when you go to grab it while they're grabbing you something to drink and you open the Bible and all the pages stick together. You haven't been in that Word of God all. It's just a showpiece. Psalm 119:11 says, I have hidden your Word in my heart that I might not sin against you. You see, if we have God's Word inside of here, which only comes through disciplining ourselves, only comes by studying it and getting into it, then what it does, it keeps us from sinning. It keeps us from being more healthier instead of being unhealthy. But we got to get it inside of here. But a lot of us have made the habit that you just want to get your dose of the Bible when pastor preaches to you on Sunday mornings. It's not enough. Folks, it is not enough. I wish it was. It's not enough. He went on to say in 2 Timothy 2:15 that we are to be diligent. I mean, keep after it. To present ourselves approved to God, what he says here, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, one who rightly divides the word of truth. Folks, the reason why the church has so many issues with each other, and believe me, I know, because I have 2 degrees. I have a ministry degree and I have a fireman degree. I put a lot of fires. Man, I can really put out some fire. Man, I tell you, you ought to see it. Like Alan said one day, Alan said, you're the only person I know that can scold somebody and they walk out of there thinking you're the greatest thing there is. You can tell who's in the Word and who's not. Because the Word of God should allow you and I to reason together on its basis, on its merits. But when you have somebody that says, you tell somebody, look, that's not what the Word of God says. They go, I don't care what it says. This is the way it's going to be. Folks, that is not mature thinking. Or it may say that, but I'm going to go to a different church. I'm just done with this thing already. All you're going to do is take the same issue over there, but you're not going to get it corrected. The Word of God is put to correct our sickness, put to bring healing to our body so that we could then be a healthy church for a community, folks. Just food for thought. It says in 2 Timothy, the third chapter, a chapter later in 16 and 17, you know the scripture, it says all scripture is God breathing or God breathing upon us, and it is useful for what? It's useful for teaching, rebuking, don't tell me that, rebuking, Pastor. Correcting, training, and righteousness. Why? So that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Now see, we like that verse as long as we're doing the training and the correcting and the rebuking. But we don't like it when the Holy Spirit does it to us, or when somebody else does it to us, only when we're in charge. Why? Because we like to be the one laying out the discipline, not the one being disciplined. Folks, let me tell you something. If we're ever going to be a healthy church, we've got to mature as a body of believers that allows the Word of God to confront us and correct us, as A.W. Tozer said. If not, we're just going to take our unhealthy ways over there and we're going to spew it on a community that's already suffering already. It's just a little food for thought. Another way for us to be a better, healthier church is we must determine to get better. Determined to get better. There's a saying that says, my get up and go has gotten up and left. Means we just don't seem to have it anymore for you to do things. You know? It's like if we can get away with somebody else feeding us, we let somebody else feed us. You know? Folks, whatever happened to our determination? There's a show I see that a lot of you probably wouldn't approve of, but they block everything off. It's called Naked and Afraid. They stick you on an island with no clothes, no food, no fire, no anything. And you got to survive 21 days there. You got to determine to make it 21 days. You got to make your own fire, make your own food, make your own clothing, you know, out of figs or whatever, like Adam and Eve did. You got to do everything, but you got to survive. There are people there that they make it. They make 21 days. There's some people there after three days, they're already tapping out. The producer had to take them back home on a helicopter. But those that make it had to determine to make it. There are people on that show, women on that show especially, that had to eat things they never thought about eating before. Think they'll make a billy goat, you know, quote, whatever, or throw up. They had to eat. But they were determined to make it to the end. Whatever happened to our resolve as a people? Americans used to always be so strong. We got to be more determined to be better. Determined to be better. See, some of us have been going through whatever it is, I believe, for so long that we have begun to give up on getting any better. We've just accepted this lot in life. We say, this is all it is for me. My best days are behind me. Oh, I used to do that, but now I don't do that anymore. Folks, let me tell you something. As long as you and I have breath in our lungs, as long as you and I have, God has us in the trenches battling Satan, we're never going to retire. We got to continue to go forward. Oh yeah, you may retire from your job, but you're not retiring from God's kingdom. I can tell you that right now. When life gets you down and life serves you up a bowl of lemons, you can either get bitter with the lemons or you can make the lemonade. When life gives you a life that's all scrambled up like a bunch of scrambled eggs, you can say, my life's not worth anything, it's scrambled up, or you can make a beautiful omelet out of your life. It's really up to you. But you got to determine to get better. Determine. And don't let anybody stop you from getting better. You say, well, what do you mean stop from getting better? It's like this. If you say, I've heard this before, believe it or not. I got these ears. The Bible says you put the ear twice as much as you talk. Or it wasn't your wife that said that. But anyway, the bottom line is, I hear things. And I've heard good willing people that said, you know what, I'm gonna invite so-and-so to my house. Or I'm gonna make it right with so-and-so. Oh, no, you don't want to do that, man. That person, nothing but trouble. Don't try to make things right with them. And we listen to what somebody else says. Folks, there got to come a time where we got to determine to be better. And say, you know what? I'm going to do the right thing, even if people around me are not doing the right thing. Amen. I'm going to do the right thing. Some of us know what I'm talking about. Some of you don't. There was a woman, you know the story, who had an issue of blood. If she would have did the right thing according to man, she never would have got her healing. You see, when you have the issue of blood, you were ostracized. You cannot be in public. You're almost like a leopard. You couldn't be there. You couldn't be seen. You were unclean. But how many of you know that when you get, how many of you have been sick and tired of being sick and tired? She got to that place in her life. She was sick and tired of being sick and tired. She was tired of going into her pocket and seeing nothing in there. She said, I got to get better here. So the Bible says in Matthew 9:20-22 that this woman who had been subjected to bleeding in for 12 years now, not we're not talking about 12 days, we're talking about 12 years, came up behind Jesus and she touched the edge of his cloak. She said to herself, if I can only touch his cloak, I will be healed. Jesus turned and saw her. He said, take heart, daughter. Your faith has healed you. And from that moment, the woman was healed of her sickness. She was determined. She fought through the crowd. She fought through maybe being stoned later. She fought through the critics. She said, I am determining to touch the edge of his cloak. I don't know about you guys, but sometimes you gotta be determined to do right by God. You got to determine to be better than you were before. Sometimes, how many of you know that, you know, y'all might think that it's easy for preachers. Sometimes even preachers got to talk themselves into going to church sometimes. A lot of you think, well, you're not so happy about being here sometimes. Not always. I wake up with pains in my body like you did. I had a long night like some of you have had, and we're going through a tough season. I don't always feel excited about coming. I'm always thankful when I do come. I always leave better than I came in. But I had to determine to get there. Yes, determined to get there. Some of you, I ain't gonna lie to you, some of you have lost that determination. It's like you treat church, I'm not trying to say y'all, maybe somebody else, maybe it is y'all, who knows. But I'm saying some of you have treated church like, I'll go if there's nothing better to do. Or I'll go, got that because it's part of my ritual, but I'll check in or check out. It just depends on how I feel. I remember I went to church with somebody a long time ago and I won't say any name, but as soon as the preacher started preaching, they took out a magazine, started reading the magazine. Never even gave the message a chance to become anything good. Folks, we got to determine in our heart to say, every time I grace these doors, I'm going to be better. Yeah. And I'm going to make people around me better. I don't care if we're at all. You know, there's a scripture verse that says, if you have an enemy, you are to shower kindness on them. It's like burning coals on them. Right. Oh, I don't talk to so-and-so because they're an enemy of mine. Guess what? Anybody here? Have I not talked to anybody here? But yeah, none of us are what you call best friends. But I will talk to you, and I will talk to you, and I will talk to you until you leave the church. I will talk to you. Because you know what? We are bound together by something greater than ourselves. It's by the blood of Jesus. You know, we don't have to like each other, but by God, we're going to love each other in the Lord. And I'm determined to do that. I'm determined to be better. Another story has in John 5, verses 1 through 8, that says, Jesus went to Jerusalem on one of these, to acknowledge one of the Jewish festivals, and now there is in Jerusalem near the Sheep Gate, a pool, they call it, which is aromatic, is called Bethesda, and which is surrounded by five covered colonnades, the story says. And here, there are a great number of disabled people used to lie near these colonnades, the blind and the lame, the paralyzed. It said one who was there had been an invalid for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, Jesus asked him, do you want to get well? And he said, sir, the invalid replied, I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. While I'm trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me. Then Jesus said to him, get up and pick up your mat and walk. Here's a man that for 38 years had been trying to get better. Just need a little bit of help. And every time he tried to get better, somebody else would take his place. But that day he cried out to Jesus and said, I want to get better. And Jesus said, guess what? Today you are better. Get your mat and go home. And he walked. Folks, this man for 38 years, no different than the woman for 12 years, had a determination to get better. Not bitter, better. I'm asking you, where are we at? Have we given up on the notion of getting better? Have we given up on the notion of thinking that tomorrow is going to be a better day than today is? Guess what, folks? Tomorrow is going to be a better day. It is. I've said it to you a couple of weeks ago, my friend Bradbury, Luke Bradbury, always says it every day. How about it, Luke? It's a good day. Some days are a little better than others, but every day is a good day. But if we wake up tomorrow morning already thinking to ourselves, I don't even want to wake up, it's going to be a bad day today. Folks, that's what we're going to get. It's going to be a better day. There's better days around the horizon for you and I. We got to determine to be better. You see, Psalm 16:8 says that I keep my eyes, the psalmist says, on the Lord. For in him at my right hand I shall not be moved. No matter what your doctor says, no matter what your banker says, no matter what your employer says, no matter what God says, I'm not going to be moved, man. You know, how many of you know that there's not a person in this room, including your pastor, first lady, and leadership team, and you guys as well, there's not nobody in this room that hadn't had a reason at one time or another to throw in the towel and give up. We've all had that reason at one time or another. But thankfully, we strap our boots up and say, you know what? I'm going to get better, man. I'm not going to get bitter. I'm going to get better. I want to give you one more D. I got these all D's here. A lot of you haven't noticed that yet. Not only discipline yourself in the Word and determine to get better, but also decide to be healed. You might say, well, what's he going with this? Decide to be healed. You know, there's a story, and I'll paraphrase, of a beggar that hung out by the gate beautiful. And every day he was lame, he couldn't walk, and every day he would beg alms for the people as they went into the temple. But what did the disciples say? They said, guess what? Silver and gold we do not have for you today. But what we do have, we'll give it to you. He says, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, get up and walk. And he got up. He accepted that healing and he walked. I say this to you because some of us have gotten to a place in our life when it comes to our healing. Physical healing, psychological healing, spiritual healing. We've gotten to a point where we don't really want to be healed. You might say, how did it? We like being the victim. Now that sounds crazy, doesn't it? But are you talking about the master fireman here? I'm telling you, I've been in a lot of arbitrations here. People like being the victim, where God wants you to be the victor. A lot of us have gotten so comfortable in being the victim, and being the one that's always this way, because it's a comfortable place to be that they never get healed, emotionally or physically or spiritually. Folks, God wants you and I to decide to be healed once and for all. Say, I am not going to accept it the rest of my life. I'm going to be healed in Jesus' name. And I'm going to get better, and I'm going to be stable in my mind, stable in my body, stable in my spiritual walk with God. It's deciding to be healed. You know, the definition of the word decide is kind of interesting here. It says it is to bring to an end in a particular way a result. Said to determine or imply a purpose to make up one's mind as what shall be done and then do it. Yeah. Once and for all, we've got to decide to be healed. Yeah. Enough's enough. If you got a battered woman who's getting beat up by her husband, I can tell you that my father was that way. I'm going to give you a little testimony. He can't beat me up. He's already passed away. My father beat my mother for like 12 years. And finally, she had enough of that. And she decided one night, in the middle of the night, to pack up kids and all the furniture and move out and divorce them. She had enough. To everybody here, there's a line in the sand that you got to finally draw and decide, today is the day. I'm done.
Yes.
And folks, I got to be honest with you. I'm not wanting anybody to leave the kingdom of God. I want your salvation to be locked in Jesus. But if you're not going to be in this thing to win this thing, then get out of it. Let's decide to win this thing for God. Let's decide to be better. Let's decide to be healed. Decide once and for all to do it, to get healing for our bodies. Now, granted, there are some healings in our bodies, some healings in our minds, some healings in our spiritual life, or relationship, or finances, or whatever that God's working on. They take time. Just because you don't get your healing today in your physical body doesn't mean you haven't decided. I'm sure you've decided. You're just waiting for God to go ahead and manifest. The same thing with Bobby and Jessica and others that are going through the Naomi. I know you've been deciding for a while back there on your healing. It just hasn't been manifested yet. But some of us have not truly decided to get well. We still like the comfortability of being the victim. It's a comfort zone that we got ourselves into. And God said, it's time to get healed already. Stop receiving alms and start receiving healing. And you might say, well, how do I do it here at the church? Well, I mean, it's a simple formula. James 5 says, is anyone among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them, what? With oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith does what? Make the sick person well. To the Lord then will raise them up. If they have sinned, they'll be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sin to each other and pray for each other so as you may be healed. He said, the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. I remember not long ago when we went to go see Alan in the hospital. He's going to have his heart cath procedure. And Pop went with me. And Alan says something. I don't know if you know he was even saying it. Alan quoted that scripture. He said, you know, it's so good that I have one of my elders here right now. My pastor and one of our elders, Pop, was there. And he said, I'd like y'all to pray over me because I'm going to stand on James right there and get my healing. You see, we have the authority to be healed right here in this church.
Amen.
And I'm not just talking about physically. You know what? You know that one of the least healings we need in this church is physical? You might say, wait a minute now, Pastor. A lot of us are hurt physically. No. I believe that a lot of us are hurt physically because we have not gotten healed emotionally. Emotionally. Once we get that, once we allow God to heal us emotionally and heal some of them deeper things that's going to be in your transforming inner man, mind you. Once we get some of that stuff dealt with, all of a sudden we start physically feeling better.
Yeah.
Folks, I'm going to tell you right now, whenever I have been down and depressed and I've been going through a tough time, my physical body feels sick.
Yeah.
Whenever my mental savvy is feeling good, all of a sudden everything else seems to be feeling a little bit better. So we got to be decided to be healed. Healed inside, in our mind, in our hearts. Solomon says in Proverbs 3, 7 and 8, do not be wise, he says, in your own eyes. Fear the Lord, shun evil. He says, this will bring health to your body and nourishment to your bones. You know, a lot of us, when he says, don't be smart in your own eyes. You know why? Because sometimes you give somebody advice, you give a brother or sister advice on getting healed, getting better. I know what I'm doing. I got the thing under control, Pastor. I've been with this person for X amount of years. My doctor gave me medicine. I know where I'm at already. You feel like saying, then just die already in yourself already. Die already. Listen, God wants us to do better than that. God has a better plan for our life than that. He says he wants to bring nourishment and health to our bodies. The Bible also talks about, I'm paraphrasing that good news is like a soothing balm to our bones. A bad news like a cancer. You know, folks, the world is strong enough, it's tough enough, it's ugly enough. We should be the healthiest things going on, the church. We should be healthy. And you say, well, what makes us not healthy? The only thing that doesn't make us healthy, there's only one person that gets in the way of that making us healthy, and that is ourselves. We are our own worst enemy. If we could just learn to get out of the way and let God be God, things would happen, folks. I want to give you one more scripture because I can tell you're starting to get upset. Psalm 28:7 says, the Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him and he helps me. My heart leaps for joy. With my song shall I praise him. You know, you say, why do you give me that? I believe, I've been saying it, I learned it from my pastor, I'm giving him all the credit, but I've kind of stolen it, I've kind of patented it from him. But I've said it, and I'm going to keep saying it, when everything is okay with us and God, it starts to be reciprocal with us and each other.
Exactly.
Don't tell me that everything going good with you and God if you don't love your brother or sister. Don't tell me everything going good with you and God if you can't talk to your brother or sister. Don't tell me everything going good with you and God if every time somebody talks to you ugly, you're that junkyard dog the rule says we got in the church. Don't tell me everything good with you and God if that's the way you act. But I will tell you, you're lying to yourself, you're deceiving yourself. But when everything's good with God, our soul's good with God, it's like it says here, my heart leaps for joy. And with my song shall I praise him. You know, it may sound very trivial. When I went to the golf tournament with Steve Parrish last year, you know, he's got the king and it's hot out there, like Hades, wasn't it? It was hot out there, man. And we're walking in. It's even harder when you have, you know, somewhat of a disability going through right now. It's even harder to get around. He was praising God. He was talking to people, singing God's praises, and all of a sudden, we started getting blessed. A guy came out of nowhere, said, "Hey man, I'll give you guys a ride." Jump in the golf cart. Took us all the way down to where we're gonna sit at. We go up there to these beautiful luxury seats. We get the best things money can buy for free. They give us food, they give us all kinds of hats and everything, right? I mean, and the guy says, "Are you military?" I said, "No, I'm just in God's army." He goes, "He's my pastor." He goes, "Well, because of him, I'm gonna honor you too." Do you know what? God says, if you start honoring him, he'll make you victorious. He'll give you favor both with God and with man.
Yes.
Folks, we've got to be determined to be better and decide to be healed. Misery loves company, you know? But guess what? If you're miserable, I don't want to hang out with you. And I wouldn't want you to hang out with me if I was miserable all the time. My wife will tell you, and I think what makes the way God uses me kind of effective is because I try to be transparent with you for your sake, you know, as much as mine. My best shining moments are standing right up here. I'm not always this shining at home sometimes. And before y'all criticize me, I bet you some of you just say, "Wait, we put a camera in one of your house, we'd be surprised what we see sometimes." You know? I'm not always sunshine and roses at home. But there's a difference, though. I want to be. And I'm making strides for it. Even here lately. I mean, I'm still learning, Steve. I'm making strides. Honey, am I making strides or what? Just say yes, I'll give you a check. I'm making strides. I'm making strides. I play with some of these guys. I'll close with this. I play with some of these guys here. They say they know how you are when you leave the church, away from the church. I play golf with some of these guys, Pastor Wang and Luke and Dale and a few others. And I tell you, it's not always an easy game out there to play. It can really test you. And but yet, in front of my brothers, I try to stay as positive as I can out there. Right, Wayne? We do. We try to stay as positive as we can out there. Not always easy, but we try. You know? And when me and Steve went to that tournament, you know, they were giving away not only free sandwiches and free soft drink, they were giving away free beer. Now, we were another city. We could have made a secret hand-packed shake and said, "You know what? Can't pass by all this free liquor. Nobody would know but us and God, and God will have God to forgive us like a good Catholic would do." But I didn't even entertain the thought, because I cared about my witness. I cared about being better. I cared about not going back to bondage and having to be healed all over again from that. You know? What am I saying to you? Your life and my life, every one of our lives are unique in God. And all I am is God's voiceman telling you what God's desire for your life is. And his desire is for you and I to be healed and set free and better. His desire for us to be disciplined in the word. His desire is for his church to be healthy. So when we go over there, we can help a sick community get healthy as well. Amen?
Amen.
You stand with me in God's house. Only a few of you give me a scowl. You just need deliverance, that's your problem. The rest of you, give me a smile. Appreciate that, it encourages me. But you know, I know it's not always easy to decide to be better. Where's David? David still here? Where's David at? David, yeah, he's sneaking around back. David doesn't speak much. He doesn't share a lot of words, but he's such a blessing, isn't he not?
Amen.
Today, come up here, come here, honey. Bring my wife to join me here. You know, like you, life isn't easy for us. You know, Billy's been out of work for some time. Now, a lot of you may not know that. It's not always easy when you're out of work. Puts a strain not only on your finances, but it puts a strain on who you are, because you want to be a contributor. You know, John remember that. John Blink could tell you that before he got to work, he just felt like, man, you know. It isn't so much of the strain on my finances, I just want to feel like I'm contributing, I'm doing something here. But even in the midst of what we're even going through right now, we still have optimism for this church. Optimism for our lives. That things are going to get better. You know? Now, we're going, because of your generosity, we're going
on a cruise here in a couple of weeks. Some of you have been puzzled. You say, I thought you went a month ago. I have not gone yet. I get that question asked every time. How was your cruise today? I haven't gone yet. I've toyed the Bobby three times already, but anyway. We're going to go in a couple of weeks. And because of God's grace and your blessings, you know, we're going to try to have the best time we can with our kids. I can't even call them kids. They're all grown up. Daniel, looking back, he says he's so grown up already, man. He's got more fuzz than I have on his face. But, she's out because I'm losing my hair. But you know what? 7 days, as blessing as that will not be a cure-all for us. It's got to be a day-to-day walking with God. A day-to-day deciding to be better. A day-to-day deciding to be healed in our body. A day-to-day discipling ourselves in God's Word and disciplining ourselves in God's Word. And that's the same thing I say to you. Because a lot of us think, if I can only get a vacation, everything will be better. It'll be better for a couple of weeks and everything will be back to normal. If you haven't had a made-up mind to be healthy, to be better. You can go to all these life groups. I'm sure they're all great. Tom and Marcia gives us good stuff. But when the life groups are over with, you're supposed to be better. And not return to the way you were before. You see? God wants us to be healthy. He wants us to be better. I guess all I'm asking, I have my wife to join me up here, but I guess what we're asking of you is just to give it a fighter's chance. Try. Make it a point to try every day to be better. To discipline yourself in the Word. To not allow a negative thing to come in as much as possible, you know? Stop being the victim. Start being the victor, you know? Stop being comfortable in where you're at. God got a better plan for you than that. And when you see what God wants to do, then you'll start to be able to say, man, God really loved me. He had a better plan for me the whole time. Today, will you bow your heads with me? I like my wife to jump here. I want her to pray for some of the people. Steve, can I use you today, please, sir? Come up here, too. Father, in the name of Jesus, as we bring this service to a close, God, you have spoken to us today about what it means to be healthy as a church believer and body. Some of us, God, have been sick in our physical bodies, our emotional status, and even our spiritual life for a long time now, God. But today, you want us to decide to be healed in Jesus' name. You want us to begin to discipline ourselves in your Word and choose to be better and not bitter. God, sometimes life does give us lemons. But God, we can choose to make lemonade. Right now, the altars are open. You don't have to give us your dirty laundry. Guess what? I don't think these two up here can handle it. But these two do want to pray with you. The Bible said that when two or three gathered in His name or gathered together, He's there in the midst of them. So if you would just come down and say, you know what? God is speaking to me today. And I want to be healthy. I want to get better. To just come down. You ain't got to give all the specifics. Let them pray an agreeing prayer with you. And God will honor you. And the healing process will start.
Yes, Lord.
It will start this day. Come down. Come down. Come down. John, actually I want to use you too. Stay here in the middle. John will be praying for people too if you need prayer. Got a touch of God in his life. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we release your Holy Spirit, God, to begin to convict the hearts and minds of people. God, right now, God, begin to give people courage to step out in faith. Courage to come down and get prayed for. Courage to make a decision in their life to be different today than they were before. May they have a made-up mind, God, to be better and not bitter. May they be willing to be confronted by the Word of God and discipline themselves in the things of God. And may they decide this day to be healed in Jesus' name. God, we can read all the books, all the health books we want. We can go through all the psychology we want. But God, if we don't have a made-up heart and mind to get better, we'll never get better. So God, today in Jesus' name, may you start the process today. May you begin to give us courage to start the process today. May we have a made-up mind to be healed today. Many of us, God, are lying at the pool, God, or beside us. We're lying there, God, just asking God to help us get in the pool, God.
Many of us like that woman with the issue of blood that are fighting through the crowd, just saying, if I could just touch God today, I'll be healed. Today, if that's you, if you're fighting through the spiritual crowd today, open your hearts to God. Let God into your heart. Grab that spiritual tassel of his robe right now and grab hold of it and be healed today in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. There's healing in the house today, God says. There's deliverance in the house today, God says. There's awakening of our spirit today in the house of God, he says. There's victory today over unemployment today, God is saying. Hallelujah. God, we give you praise today for what you're doing here today. We know, God, you're making a house healthy today. God, you're making us a healthy body of believers that's going to impact this community, God, and the community we're going to in Jesus' name. Oh, God, when people come to them doors, God, they're going to see a healthy church. And they themselves are going to be healthy in Jesus' name. God, you're going to make our women's ministry healthy, our men's ministry healthy, our children and youth ministry healthy, God, our nursery healthy, our worship team, our sound booth ministry, God, our missionary, our altar time, God, the word. God, you're going to make us healthy across the board in Jesus' name. Our food pantry, God, are going to touch lives and bring strength to bodies that are starving, God, in Jesus' name. God, today, in the name of Jesus, may we be decided today to be healthy, to be set free once and for all. We don't have to wait 12 years like the woman with the issue of blood. We don't have to wait 38 years like the man lying near the pool beside him. Today we can determine once and for all to be healed, to be set free, to be healthy. Hallelujah. 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 I do this every once in a while. I feel led to do it right now. I want you to pray for the person next to you. Just pray for the person next to you. You might say, I don't know how to pray. Then pray in your prayer language. Let the Holy Spirit pray for you, but pray for the person next to you. Have body ministry happening right now. Pray for the person next to you. We got to be a healthy church, so pray for the person next to you to be healthy. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're just about done here. Don't lose your blessing in the last hour here. Don't lose your blessing in the last 30 seconds here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory. Glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 To God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Hallelujah. 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 Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Lives are being changed even as we speak. These folks up here are being ministered to like you are, and God is touching them. Satan thought they were going down one road or going down another in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you have to be dismissed, we dismiss you in the name of the Lord. We don't want to hold you up for the place you have to be. Be blessed in the name of God. Try to be respectful for those being prayed for up here. Hallelujah.